Went to Brown University and studied geology. Before that, he comes from the country up north, Canada, and received a fellowship in science and engineering to go to grad school at Brown, and now he's doing a postdoc at UT Austin and has a fellowship there for that. It's the Jackson School of Geosciences postdoc. And one of the very special things about having Tim Goudge here this week is that last week we were in LA and discussing Mars landing sites, and the site that Tim is proposing is the one that was ranked the highest, Jezero. So he's going to be telling you about this. It's going to be exciting news, perhaps, where our next Mars 2020 rover is going. So I'll let Tim go ahead and start. Welcome, Tim.
Great. Well, thanks for having me here. I'm excited to give this talk. And happy Valentine's Day to everyone. Gonna hopefully today make everybody fall in love with a delta deposit on Mars. So, as Janice mentioned, last week in Monrovia, we did the workshop for the next landing site for the Mars 2020 rover. Me and the team that presented Jezero got sort of partway in making the Mars 2020 rover fall in love with Jezero. It's in the top three now, so along with Northeast Syrtis and Columbia Hill. So moving forward, this will be a really exciting thing to keep working with. And so Jezero crater, and specifically the river delta deposit in it, is what I'm going to be talking to you about today. So just for a bit of background, sort of starting from the beginning, Mars today is a very cold and dry planet. So average surface temperatures, minus 60 degrees Celsius, very, very cold. It also has a very thin atmosphere, so about 1% of Earth's atmospheric pressure. And the amount of water in the atmosphere is also very, very small. So the way you measure this is the precipitable micron. So if you took the entire atmospheric column, collapsed it down, how thick would the water layer be? On Mars, we're talking about tens of microns of water in the atmosphere. Microns for scale is what you measure human hairs in, so very, very limited amount of water. On the Earth, we're talking centimeters, so much drier place than the Earth. And sort of going back in Mars exploration to the very, very earliest part, so in the 1870s, Giovanni Schiaparelli first mapped out surface features on Mars. You can see this map here. This is a map he put together of the surface features on Mars from telescopic data. And he mapped out these features that he called canali. And what he was mapping out here were just linear features that he was referring to as channels. But of course, canali, the Italian word, sounds like canals. And so that spawned much interest in possible canals and possible life on Mars, with water flowing in these canals and Martians pushing gondolas through them, things like this. So it sparked much interest. One of the sort of more famous stories of people that ran with this idea is Percival Lowell. And this is a thing I like to show that is an article published in the New York Times in 1906, and the headline reads, "There is life on the planet Mars." It goes on to say, "Professor Percival Lowell, recognized as the greatest authority on the subject, declares there can be no doubt that living beings inhabit our neighbor world." So this is something you could have read in the New York Times over 100 years ago. So much fascination with Mars. So NASA obviously is very excited to get there, so you can imagine the disappointment when the first images from Mariner 4 come back and show this, right? No canali, no Martians, no gondolas. A surface that looks actually much more like the moon that we're familiar with. So this is in the mid-60s, and NASA is continuing their space exploration program, and they continue with the Mariner program, and then Mariner 9 in the mid-70s sends back the first evidence of Martian water. Not flowing water in canals, but geologic evidence for water in the past. So very large river valleys, valleys that were carved by flowing water at some point in their history. So this is really exciting and has really pushed much of the field of planetary exploration for the surface of early Mars. And over the past 40 years, since that original Mariner 9 identification of the valleys, the Martian valley networks, really over 40 years of this research has indicated that there's abundant evidence for early flowing water on the surface. So things like lake basins, you can see an example. Here where there's a large basin with inlets that maybe are flowing in and outlets flowing out, water would have ponded in here. You also see deposits, sedimentary rock deposits that are formed by flowing water. So this is the example of the Jezero Crater Delta that I'm going to be talking about today. This is something like the Mississippi River Delta that you see at the mouth of the Mississippi as it flows into the Gulf of Mexico. Sediment being transported by a river and being deposited in a standing body of water. So you can take all of this information of Mars's geologic past and its early geologic history associated with water, and you can come up with a very sort of schematic timeline of what water activity on Mars has looked like over time. So Mars's geologic history is broken up into three major epochs: the Amazonian, which goes from present-day cold Mars to sort of 3.5 billion years, the Hesperian, which goes from about 3.5 to about 3.7, and then the Noachian, which goes from about 3.7 to about 4. And then this is the part of Mars's record that we actually don't see on the surface, so the very earliest parts of Mars's history. But it's right around this Noachian-Hesperian boundary, right around 3.7, 3.8 billion years ago, that we think surface water activity peaked. And so this is when all of these rivers, or most of these rivers and lakes were forming, and since then, the water activity has been declining. And so it's this period of Mars's history that I'm most interested in, and that I think Jezero Delta really captures. And so that's sort of the period I'm going to be talking to you about today. So obviously the question is, okay, well, what happened? Where did all the water come from? Where did it go to? If you look at the surface of Mars and you look at the poles in particular, what you actually see is huge polar ice caps. The amount of frozen liquid water in here is the equivalent volume of the Mediterranean Sea. Or if you think about it in terms of the surface area of Mars, if you spread this amount of water taken in the northern and southern polar caps, spread it across the surface of Mars evenly, you get a layer that's about 20 or 30 meters thick. So it's a significant amount of water. So we have the water there. So the question really becomes, well, where did the liquid water come from and go to? And this is a really good question that's sort of at the forefront of early Mars science and Martian exploration. And the problem is the atmosphere of early Mars. We don't think it's really easy to get the surface very warm to have liquid water. So these are some plots from global climate models. The top shows annual mean temperatures, and the bottom shows maximum daily mean temperatures. And to get liquid water, this is for early Mars, to get liquid water, you need to be in these deep reds up here. This is in degrees Kelvin. So you don't really get those surface temperatures across the surface with CO2 atmosphere that's thicker than modern Mars. This involves a 500 millibar atmosphere, so about half the atmospheric pressure of Earth. But regardless, it's very difficult to get these surface temperatures that we see the geologic record for. And the problem is something that perhaps many of you are familiar with, the faint-young-sun paradox. And essentially, this is a plot of solar intensity versus time, and the sun has been getting brighter over time. So if you go back to this time period when we think all of these valleys were active, you're at about 75% solar luminosity. That, coupled with the fact that Mars's orbit is about 50% further from the sun than Earth's, it's very, very difficult, just the amount of solar radiation you have on the surface. This is very difficult to get the surface warm. And so this has led to two major N-member hypotheses for what the early Martian climate might have looked like. The top here is a persistently warm climate. People often refer to this as a warm and wet early Mars, where you have rainfall and surface runoff and sort of constant or temperatures that are near or above or above the freezing point. And so you have rainfall going off, surface runoff, groundwater table flowing into lakes, a very similar hydrologic cycle to what we have on Earth. The competing hypothesis that's really been driven by the sort of best and most comprehensive climate models we have is that the atmosphere was perhaps only transiently warm. So most of the time, early Mars is very cold, and you snow on the surface. You have lots of snowfall accumulating on the surface. And then you have transient events that perturb the climate system. So something like a large impact crater or volcanic outgassing, something like that, that's able to really warm up the atmosphere significantly, melt all this snow that you've been accumulating, and have surface runoff flow and form these features that we see the geologic evidence for. And so the question that I want to address and that we can address as planetary geologists is trying to test these models with observation. So we want to refine our knowledge of the early Martian climate and hydrology by looking specifically at the sedimentary rock record. Why sedimentary rocks? Well, sedimentary rocks, they record the conditions of fluid flow and sediment transport that are responsible for building them. So you can see here just a little simple animation of subaqueous ripples, so ripples forming as water flows back and forth across it. Here's this fluid flow field, velocity and height, and you can see it's going back and forth, the sediment's moving back and forth, and this gets recorded by a deposit. So this is a deposit on the coast of Oregon that's recorded ripples much like this. And so you can back out that information by studying the sedimentary rock record on Mars. The problem, obviously, is study scale, right? Study scale is a major constraint on Mars. We do have some images like this. This is taken from Gale Crater. The MSL rover is there right now. And looking at things, very fine scale structures, similar to what I showed on the last slide, where you can really interrogate the rock record to say, okay, what are these layers recording, and what was the flows that built this, either wind or water? Problem is, we only have these in a few locations. MSL is the most recent one. Mars 2020 is the next one that's going to go up. It's going to launch in 2020. So if you sent that to Jezero Crater, you could get images like this. But most of what we have is orbital coverage. So satellites orbiting the planet, collecting data of the surface. And so you have a much broader view of the surface geology. Luckily, engineers are very smart, and they know that optics can help us with this problem. So this is the high-rise camera. So this is essentially a telephoto lens. So you see people often, you know, walking around with their DSLR cameras. This is a very souped-up version of that. Here's a person for scale. And so these type of optics allow us to get images of the surface of Mars. This camera, the high-rise instrument, it can get images with a scale of 25 centimeters per pixel. So this screen we're looking at would easily be resolved by the high-rise camera if it were laying flat on the Martian surface. So what type of data do we have? What type of data am I going to be showing you? Two types, really: high-resolution images and stereo-derived topography. So for the images, mostly I'll be focusing on data from two instruments, both on the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, the CTX instrument, which gives us images at about 6 meters per pixel, and the high-rise instrument, which, as I said, gives us images at about 25 centimeters per pixel. You can also do with these images, you can create stereo-derived topographic models. And so the principle behind this is quite simple. You have a spacecraft flying across the surface. It looks, takes an image, continues on its path, looks back, takes an image of the same spot, and you can use the disparity in those images to see what the elevation data is. We do this with our eyes every day. The reason we have depth perception is because we have two eyes spaced apart some distance, and our brain can process that to tell us how far away objects are. And so you can do this either a long track like this or in sequential orbits, taking images of the same spot. And you can get very high resolution elevation or topographic models of the surface. You can get elevation data up to about a meter per pixel. And so when HiRISE first started collecting data in sort of late 2006, people were putting this stereo-derived topography together, and some really clever people figured out that you can actually do stratigraphy, so look at the structures of sedimentary rocks from orbit by combining the image data, overlaying it on topography, and doing things that you would do in the field as a geologist, looking at what the orientation of different layers are and comparing that over a broad region. So you can actually look at the broad scale stratigraphy. And so a major take-home point I'm going to try and drive home in this talk is that using only orbital data, looking with images and stereo-derived topography of the surface, we can actually provide some very good quantitative constraints on how sedimentary rock deposits have evolved on the surface of Mars, and we can integrate this information to try and understand what the past surface environments might have been like. So what's the study site here? It's, as I've been saying over and over, it's Jezero Crater Paleolake. Jezero Crater is about 45-kilometer diameter impact crater. It has flowing into it two inlet valleys and an outlet valley. And so we can define a minimum lake level required for this overflow. And the volume of water contained within this basin below that minimum lake level is something like 250 cubic kilometers, which is comparable to Lake Tahoe or Lake Winnipeg. So a very large body of water. We also know that the age of this basin, Caleb Fassett and Jim Head in 2008 did a nice study where they studied the ages of many valley network systems, and they came up with an age of about 3.8 billion years for this Jezero crater system. And so it sits right in this sort of peak fluvial activity period we want to study. So it's very well positioned in terms of its timing. It records the early Mars conditions that we're interested in. Also importantly, at the mouth of both of these fan deposits, at the mouth of both of these inlet valleys is a fan deposit. This is the western fan that is the better preserved of the two, and it's being eroded back, and so it's exposing its internal structure. So we can do the things you want to do in field geology from orbit. And so that's what this talk is going to be focused on. And there are three goals that I'm going to try and address during this talk. First, we want to understand, where did this actually form? What's the depositional environment of this fan? Then we want to try and reconstruct how it evolved using the channel deposit, so the sedimentary record of channels. And then finally, we want to integrate these results to hopefully provide some constraints on the early Martian climate. So this first goal, the depositional environment, when you see a fan deposit like this, there are two major competing end members that might be the depositional environment. Either an alluvial fan, which forms entirely subaerially, so only under air. This is a fan deposit familiar to things, an alluvial fan familiar to things you see in Death Valley, that as a river flows out from steep topography, it hits a break in slope. It deposits out a huge amount of sediment. So this involves water, but there's no standing body of water associated with it. It's just forming under subaerial conditions. A delta deposit is different. This is the Wax Lake Delta, which is an offshoot from the Mississippi River Delta in Louisiana. And this involves both subaerial and subaqueous deposition. So all of this topography shown here, where reds are high and blues are low, this is all actually underwater. And so the deposition here is not controlled in the same way for the alluvial fan by the break in slope, but it's actually controlled by the standing body of water. You have a river flowing into a lake or a sea, that water can't move anymore, so it drops out its sediment and forms a delta deposit like this. So we want to test between these two depositional environments because it gives us a very important constraint of whether or not this fan that we're interested in, was it actually forming when Jezero Crater hosted a lake, or perhaps it formed earlier or after Jezero hosted the lake. So it's previously been interpreted as a delta based mostly on morphology and the fact that it sits within this lake. The problem with using morphology alone, so looking at just the surface textures and surface distribution of features, is that we're not looking at a geomorphic surface that's active. So we're not looking at an active delta. We're looking at rock, We're looking at a rock outcrop that has been eroded, and so is exposing not the morphology, but exposing the stratigraphy. And so that's a very important point here, that the evidence is in the stratigraphy, not in the sort of surface plan form, but we want to actually look at what the layers are doing and what are the layer orientations and their geometries with respect to each other. And again, these two depositional environments give us a very distinct stratigraphic signature. Alluvial fans mostly have sub-parallel layering. Delta deposits, on the other hand, give us these very well-studied cliniform structures where you have shallow sloping river deposits in the sort of sub-aerial portion. As you hit the shoreline, you deposit very steep dipping foreset deposits, and then those shallow out as you go further into the basin. These shallow portions are called bottom sets here. So this is what we want to look for, try and distinguish between these two. And so what we can do is look at the eroded or exposed portions of the Jezero fan. And this front along the deposit, this is all erosional. The fan's been eroded back by aeolian activity, wind sort of blowing at it and sand pelting it. And so it exposes the stratigraphy. So if we zoom in, here to the portion of the eroded front, we can see that we're going to see some exposed stratigraphy here. So this here, these are layers we can see exposed. And if we do a perspective view, as if we're looking back towards the deposit like this, what you see is this. So this is 2x vertical exaggeration. You can see these layers here very clearly defined. And so what we do with this is map these layers out. We can extract the information in 3 dimensions, and then we can fit a plane to that. So here's examples of plane fits to these 2 layers. So this is approximating the orientation and the slope or the dip angle of these exposed strata. So this is exactly what you'd do with a compass, a Brunton compass, if you were doing field geology. So what we see here, this geometry where you have higher units that are more steeply dipping and lower units that are more shallowly dipping, this is very consistent with what we'd expect for a deltaic depositional environment. If you look around the front of the deposit, you actually see similar things. Low layers are flat-lying, higher layers are more steeply dipping. And if you look at this in a sort of more quantitative sense, what I have plotted here is the dip angle versus the mean layer elevation, so how high you are on this front. And this is a very good proxy for stratigraphic position, so how high up in the stratigraphy you are. And you can see this clear trend of increasing dips as you get higher and higher. So this is simply a quantitative metric of what I just showed you in those 2 examples. And so what's going on here? Well, if we think back to our simple delta stratigraphy, as I said, it's building out in these cliniforms. Shallow, steep, shallow. If you then erode this deposit, as we know has happened at Jezero, so you chop off the front here, what you get is that you're actually exposing different stratigraphic intervals. And so the lowest layers should have low dips, and you go up through these cliniforms, and you're expecting this increase in layer dip that we observe. And so what we see here is that these lower layers, we're interpreting them as bottom sets, whereas these higher layers are more indicative of foresets, so along the front of the delta. So that gives us the indication that Jezero is in fact a delta. It was forming when the crater hosted a lake or hosted a standing body of water. So this was building out into a lake. So the second project goal here is to try and reconstruct how this delta deposit evolved. So what was its life cycle? And we do this by looking at channel deposits, so the sub-aerial portion of the delta where the river channels are actually forming, they leave behind a record, and we look at those. And so we've mapped out the types of stratigraphy we see on the top, and there are 2 classes of channel deposits, mapped in blue and red on here, so they have distinct positions, and I'm going to walk through each of them and what our interpretations are for these. So the first example here is these inverted features. So this is topography where warm colors, whites, reds are high, cool colors, blues, purples are low. And you can see that we're actually looking at ridges here, so topographically high features. And we're interpreting these as inverted channel deposits. So what does that mean? So we're looking here on the left. This is from Google Earth set of images where we have time lapse going from 1984 to 2006 in the Himalaya Foreland Basin. And you can see this river here. It starts 1984. It's flowing this way. And then eventually it switches directions. This is called an avulsion, where the river channel chooses a new path on the landscape. So it goes from flowing over here slowly, and then it goes over here. This leaves behind a record of rock, something like this, where these sort of tabular things you see, this is the sand that we expect to be deposited by the river. Surrounding this is more fine material, so mud kind of material, that's from overbank deposition of these rivers. So that's leaving a finer grained material. And then this gets cemented into rock, and eventually as you erode this surface, the fine grained material is easier to remove than the coarse sand, which will likely have been cemented better. And so that leaves these inverted ridges as a record of what was once a channel. And so we see that these channel bodies are stacked one upon each other. So this is a perspective view looking back up like this. We can see distinct levels of these channel bodies. And they really seem to be stacked on top of each other. So why they actually stack on top of each other is a good question, and we have to think about how these channel bodies a bit more, how they're forming. So if we're looking at a cross-section here, here's our channel, water is flowing either in or out of the page. We have sand in yellow here and fine-grained clay material in gray. So the channel starts, it's lower than the exterior floodplain. Everything's happy, the water's going downhill, it's great. The channel floor builds up. You have deposition within the channel that is faster than the deposition outside. So this channel, it raises its elevation faster than the surrounding terrain. So it leaves behind this channel deposit, and eventually you reach some level where the depth of the channel is approximately equal to the depth of the exterior terrain. So the floor of the channel is sitting level with the exterior surface. So you're super elevated here. And that's obviously a gravitationally unstable situation. So the channel will respond to this by choosing a new lower energy path in one of these avulsions. So like what I just showed a few slides ago. So it will form a new path over here that is lower than the floodplain. So the channel again is in a gravitationally stable configuration. But the abandoned channel leaves behind as still a low on the landscape. So there's still this sort of hole where that hasn't been filled in from this low background floodplain sedimentation. So when this new channel, when it reaches a point where it's ready to avulse to a new location on the landscape, it's going to be most attracted to this previous channel site because that's the low on the landscape. And so it will preferentially hop back there. And that's been shown through a lot of really nice modeling work as well as observational work of Earth's rivers. And so these new channels will build up and you'll eventually get multiple stack deposits. The channel keeps revisiting the same locations when it's ready to avulse. So we have this record of a very avulsive system, a system where the channels are really moving around. They're occupying lots of different locations on the landscape. We see that from the stacking nature. We also see here, these are all of the channel bodies we've mapped in blue. The black is the direction, the flow directions we infer from these channel bodies. You can see that the spread is very large. So these channels are moving all the way around this landscape here. So the question for these channels is, well, why are they so avulsive? What's driving this very rapid sedimentation? And it's driven, as I said, this avulsion process is driven by sedimentation on the floor of the channel. And what you see in this plot is the distance from the inlet for each of our mapped channel bodies versus the elevation. And what you have is a very strong negative trend here. And what we think this is an indicator of is transgression or shoreline retreat. What you have when you have relative sea level rise, or lake level rise. These channels will backstep as the lake level gets higher and the shoreline moves closer and closer to the land. So that's what we think this signature is here. One of the other things we can do is look at the geometry of these channel deposits. And we know that channels will aggrade the leave-behind deposit that's about the same thickness as the flow depth. This has been shown from terrestrial field studies. And so what we can do is model these inverted channel geometries. We can fit a plane to their top. So here we have fit to this layer. We can fit to the layer above it and get a thickness estimate for this channel deposit. And that gives us a very rough proxy, sort of a first order proxy of what the flow depth for these channels was. And if we do that for a statistically relevant grouping of channels, we get a mean of about 1.5 meters with most of our values between 0 and 2 meter flow depth. So relatively shallow channels that we interpret as being very near towards the coast. So very near towards the shoreline. For our second class of channel stratigraphy, it's shown in red here. It is stratigraphically lower, so it's only exposed in windows through these inverted ridges and is much lower in elevation. And what we see are these sort of alternating dark and light toned curved features. And what we're interpreting these as is depositional packages from point bars. So point bars form on the inner banks of meandering rivers. So it's this sand deposit here. This is the Trinity River in Texas. These very large sand deposits that grow up and that grow as the river migrates and leave behind these individual layers that trace out the point bar movement. So what does this actually look like? Here's a picture of a very rapidly meandering river in the Foreland Basin of the Andes. So you can see these curves moving out, and eventually they get cut off, but they move out, and that movement is recorded by point bar growth. So how do point bars actually grow? Again, we can look at this in a sort of cartoon schematic way. If you have a river, this is a cross section here. Here's our point bar. Your river's flowing. During sort of normal background flow, not much is happening within the point bar. Point bar is sort of just at a more or less stable state. But when you have flood conditions, so be it a yearly flood, decadal flood, things like this, very large floods that are able to overtop the river, what you get is erosion of the outer bank and deposition on the inner bank, and that drives the migration. So this is a cross section of the channel. So during floods, this pushes out this way. And you repeat this process during low flow, not much happens. And then during high flow, you have the lateral migration. Another sort of important point about these point bars is that meander migration rate, so how much rivers move, is really, really drops as you near the coastline. So this is a plot of the meander migration rate in meters per year versus distance from the shoreline. This is for the Mississippi River. So you can see once you reach this sort of 500 kilometers above the shoreline, you really drop your lateral migration rates to very, very close to zero. And then you have much higher in the sort of more distal portions of the river, so as it's further from the shoreline. So we actually think these point bar strata for the Jezero deposit specifically record a period of delta growth when the shoreline of the lake must have been farther towards the basin center. So again, we want to look at the geometry of these deposits. The point bar height, indicated by T here, this is representative of the flow depth during flood in the curves or in the bend of the river. The cross-sectional geometry of this is more triangular, whereas if you go into straight reaches of the river, so the portions of the river that connect two different meanders, they have more of a symmetric cross-section. And so this depth turns out to be about a factor of 3 larger than the mean depth. So we can take these point bar heights. If we can measure point bar heights from the geometry, then we can divide by 3 to get our mean flow depth. So how do we model the point bar geometry? I'm going to show you this example mapped in red here. We map these all out, we do a perspective view, here's the one we're going to look at. You map it out in three dimensions, extract the topography all the way along here, and then go through a fitting algorithm where we fit that surface with a downward opening paraboloid. So it's essentially just a bowl that can squish in all dimensions, and it can rotate freely around the z-axis. So it can give us the best fit to this point bar surface that is trying to reconstruct the topography going from low to high here. So this is our model reconstruction of what the point bar surface might have actually looked like during deposition of these layers. And so we can take that model surface, measure the height of it from the peak, the apex here, to the lowest exposed portion of the stratigraphy, which gives us a minimum estimate of the height. And then we can use our factor of three conversion to get what the mean flow depth was during flood conditions for these rivers. And that gives us a flow depth of about 6.5 meters, most of our values lying between 5 and 10 meters. So what does this channel geometry tell us if we compare between the two types of stratigraphy? Well, we see that the meandering channels are significantly bigger by a factor of 4 approximately. And so this is consistent with also what we see in the stratigraphy where you probably have a more upstream portion of the river that's meandering, that's much deeper, and then the coastal portion of the river as you split into multiple active channels. You saw with Wax Lake there are multiple active channels at one time, and so the water is partitioned amongst more channels, and so you have shallower coastal channels and much deeper upland channels or upstream channels. And so as I mentioned before, the stratigraphy is that the inverted channels are overlying our point bar deposits. And so this signature is again, it's a characteristic signature of shoreline transgression, shoreline retreat. It's also termed auto-retreat, and I'll just step through what that might have looked like for this, the evolution of this delta. So initially you have a river flowing in, filling the basin. The delta is probably building out new land as water is filling up the basin. Eventually you reach a point where water and sediment flowing into the basin can't fill up all of this space. But the water level is still rising. You have water flowing in, you just don't have enough sediment. So you begin your shoreline transgression. So your shoreline used to be here, and then it backsteps. And this continues on. You have these backstepping channels here. And that gives us the backstepping signature we see in the elevation. Eventually, the deposit, the lake sort of dies, it goes away, and the deposit's eroded to its current form, what we actually see today. So that's sort of our understanding of the evolution of this fan deposit, this delta. And now we want to try and say something about what this means for the early Martian climate. And so there are two, I think, really important points to make here about what the stratigraphy tells us. First, when we look at this, when we look at the deposit, we don't see any major erosional unconformities. Something you might expect if the lake level is really fluctuating up and down. So you go from high lake level to low lake level and back and forth like this. Instead, the model we've put forth here for delta evolution requires mostly continuous basin filling. So the lake level starts from very low and then rises continuously as this delta forms. And so this tells us that the climate under which the delta formed on early Mars, it must have been sufficiently long-lived to fill the basin approximately continuously without any major lake level drops. The other important point here is the mere fact that we see these point bar strata and large groups of them that migrate many, many, many distances that are of the flow depth that we estimate. And each of these strata, as I sort of pointed out in this cartoon, each stratum here represents one or perhaps a few flood events. So this is telling us that the climate during the formation of this delta was such that it had regional flooding. So it wasn't continuous flow through the crater. It was approximately continuous, where you don't have major drops in lake level, but you do have regional flooding and high periods of high flow separated by periods of low flow, much like you have in terrestrial river systems. And so if you think back to sort of the two N-member hypotheses I posed at the very start, persistently warm and transiently warm, and if you compare this to our stratigraphic record from Jezero, what you come away with, I think, is that really a persistently warm climate is what's consistent with our observations. So the climate, at least during the formation of this delta deposit, was persistently warm. It filled the basin approximately continuously, but it had regional flooding that was modulated at something like annual to decadal timescales because we don't see major erosion between the point bar strata. So just to quickly conclude about Jezero here, the fan stratigraphy tells us that this is a river delta depositional environment. The channel deposits, they record shoreline transgression and auto-retreat as the basin filled and eventually breached, and that this approximately continuous filling and flooding is most consistent with a persistently warm early Mars climate. And as I mentioned at the very start, the Mars 2020 rover launched in 2020. We're currently in the process of selecting landing sites. And this rover has a suite of instruments you can see here. Very impressive suite of instruments. It's also the first in a proposed series of sample return. So it might collect, it's going to drill samples that might one day be returned to Earth. And so it's going to explore geology, habitability, the potential for past life at a site on the surface of Mars. And as I said, the crater and the delta deposit has made it into the final three, and just sort of the one slide pitch here is that there are additional other units of interest within the basin that I wasn't able to talk about, but the delta itself, it's recording the environmental conditions of early Mars, which is a very large problem that is difficult to tackle that a lot of people are working on. So this would offer very unique insights into early Mars. And this lake sediment also has very excellent accumulation and preservation potential for organic matter. So it'll be a very exciting place to go in terms of astrobiology. And with that, I'll just show some acknowledgments, funding, and people that have helped me with this, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Questions? I'll try to hand you a microphone.
Yeah, that was masterful, I must say. about five slides back, you showed some orthogonal wavelet in the... one more? Yeah, here. That's right. What can you say about this wavelet that you see in the...
Things like this?
No, that's right.
Here.
Go up a bit. That's it. Now, if you go east, if you will. No. The wavelets that you can see right there, yeah.
There. What these things?
That's right.
Those are dunes. Those are surficial dunes that are sitting on top and are actually probably doing the work to expose these. So those are not, those are modern features.
Okay.
Those are modern deposits, not part of this, or modern geomorphic things that are not part of this this deposit, actually. Yeah, it's probably sand derived from this, actually, yeah.
You were mentioning that there was enough ice on Mars currently so that if it were liquid, it would spread out to a substantial depth. I don't remember whether it was a meter or something of that order.
20 to 30 meters, something like that, yeah.
If Mars was warmer earlier, as you're speaking of here, one would expect a lot of that water to vaporize and cause a very moist atmosphere. What kind of result would that show up? Would we see some aspect of that? Would it... in fact, help keep the planet warm if it were thick enough?
That's a really good question, right? You know, water is a fantastic greenhouse gas. So if you pump enough water into the atmosphere, it's kind of a chicken or egg, right? You need water in the atmosphere to keep it as liquid water, but you can't have it liquid water. But as it turns out, the newest sort of most comprehensive set of climate models we have, even if you have large amounts of water. So if you add all of the water you have on Mars's surface and even more water than that, it does warm the atmosphere, but not enough to give you liquid water. So we think there is a signature of liquid water, obviously, in all of this geology, but the water alone isn't enough to give you the greenhouse warming you need to get above 0°C. So it's definitely something people have tried, and it's probably one of the responsible culprits for greenhouse warming, but it alone is not enough.
I'll start front and go back.
So two questions. One, when you talk about a persistent warm period, what are you talking about in terms of temperature?
Well, temperature, so yeah, warm is means it's beauty's in the eye of the beholder, right?
Right, right.
Warm is 1 degree C. 1 degree C. I'm from Toronto, so
that's a heat wave up there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So warm means warmer than 0 C, warm enough to have liquid water. Because the surface temperatures mostly you get with these climate models are minus 30 degrees C, minus 20 degrees C, so much colder. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you talk about the water levels and the amount of water that formed this topography, I assume that's much more than is currently locked up in the poles, so that there's no?
No, the amount of water you have on the surface. So we have lots of these features, these basin lake features. Mm-hmm. The amount of water, if you filled all of those up, it would be 10% of what's in the current poles. And so you probably need to cycle the water a lot to do the geomorphic work to carve these river valleys. You can't just have it all sitting there once. So you need to figure out a way to cycle it. But the amount of water is not the problem.
So the suggestion is not that Mars has lost its water.
There is other independent evidence that suggests Mars has lost water. Hydrogen isotopes, essentially, from the atmosphere indicate that water is leaving the atmosphere. And the MAVEN mission that's there right now, that's one of the questions it's trying to address. So it has lost water. And some put it as a large amount of water it's lost. But that's not necessarily the answer. You have enough water on the surface to do a lot of work. It's just too cold. It's just ice.
Even for Toronto.
Yeah, even for Toronto. Yeah, go Leafs.
We had some in the back, and then we'll come back.
Okay. Great talk. I was just curious. Do you have? You gave these kind of rule of thumb scaling relationships, and you know, what is your take on how robust that is against the gravity difference?
There's two things on Earth. They're within a range. So I show that approximately 3 times the depth. That's actually something like 2 to 4 based on all of the data that they collect. Geologic systems are messy. There's lots of confounding variables. For the gravity scaling, the way the physics operates for sediment transport obviously is dependent on gravity. But actually, if you go through the sort of theoretical calculations of what's controlling the geometry of these rivers, it should fall out that gravity isn't going to be as important here. So it's probably just fine to use that type of scaling.
Hi, great talk.
Thanks.
I'm looking at the pictures here, and maybe it's just a naive intuition on my part, but it looks, we're talking about a landscape formed by rivers and lakes. How much of the landscape was formed by rain? Can we tell by the information we have?
So rainfall specifically, as opposed to just rainfall collecting in water. So so we think this could either be the rivers that sourced this lake could either be from snowmelt or it could be from rain. So it doesn't really matter in terms of the river where the water comes from. But rainfall itself leaves a independent mark of geomorphology. And people have argued that some of the things you see in the shapes of craters actually suggest that it might be rainfall. It's a phenomenon called the rain splash, where you have literally a raindrop falling, splashing up small amounts of sediment, and it's a very diffusive weathering process. And so people have suggested that is actually can explain some of the topography we see for craters where you don't see some of these rivers incising them. Whether it's an interesting idea, and I think there's probably more to be done on it, but rain does leave some independent signals, and things like MSL and Mars 2020, if you go to some of these sedimentary archives, On Earth, you can find places where rain is recorded in mud deposits. You can see raindrops in the rock record. So if you see that on Mars, right, that's very indicative that it's a rainfall environment and not snowfall. So it's definitely something I think the rover team is probably keeping an eye out for.
Okay. In an early slide, you showed sulfur dioxide coming out of a volcano, and I wondered if there's, you know, if a plausible amount of sulfur dioxide or other volcanic greenhouse gases could have come out and lasted long enough to give this warm episode.
Yeah, so that's sort of here. People have done modeling with sulfur, with SO2 as the greenhouse warming, and SO2 is an interesting one because initially it warms as a greenhouse gas, but then it forms sulfur aerosols and probably cools the planet. There has been some work that suggests sulfur mixed with carbon dioxide and perhaps hydrogen might be enough to do the warming in these sort of transient events that link with these volcanic activities. Oh, coming out here? Yeah, things like these are all things that people are trying. I myself am not a climate modeler, so I don't know sort of what the latest is on all of these species as greenhouse gases, but it is definitely, people are throwing the gamut at it because we have the evidence that Mars had liquid water on it, but it's tough to get the climate that warm.
Let's have one more question.
Thanks. Regarding your evidence for flooding, the annual to decadal flooding, do you see any changes in the magnitude of the flooding, which might suggest seasonal versus something that's more highly variable, like maybe, I don't know, glacial processes being associated with, or some other processes?
That's a really good question. I think probably you're at the limit of resolution here. These layers we're looking at are, you know, a meter most of thickness. A really interesting question would be to do some sort of mapping along here and try and pulling out thicknesses and doing some frequency analyses of it. As far as I can tell, I'm just not sure, but I don't think that it can be anything longer, like glacial, interglacial cycles that are controlled by the orbit, because you see these continuously migrating across hundreds of meters with no evidence for erosion in between them. So if it was floods every 10,000 years, you would expect other processes to be operating and that would erode some of these deposits. So you'd have very unusual unconformities in here that we don't see. So it's probably more, we suggest it's probably more like something annual to decadal flooding, but between those, it could be daily flooding too. Between those, I don't have an answer for you, but it's a great question.
Great. Well, let's thank our speaker again, Dr. Tim Goudge.
Thanks a lot.
And I'd like to thank everyone for coming, and we'll see you next week again.